Well, good morning. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to talk to you today about diversity and inclusion. And while I work at Microsoft, and a lot of the stories that I'm going to tell you today are Microsoft specific, I kind of look at the world through my Microsoft lens. I've been there for 17 years or so. I'm hoping that there's enough learnings out of the things I'm going to talk about that you can apply no matter where your academic or eventual career is going to take you. So please pardon my introduction of a bunch of Microsoft stories as part of this discussion. One slight subtle difference between Gandhi's intro and my role. Every organization at Microsoft has an executive sponsor for diversity and inclusion these days. So I happen to be that sponsor for our division, but I have a bunch of colleagues across the company who are trying to drive similar things in their organization. And primarily that role is about attracting, retaining, and developing diverse talent in our group. So that's what we're primarily responsible for. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. Blah, 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 blah. I've been at Microsoft for 16 years. I've done a bunch of different things. I tend to contribute a lot in a couple NGOs. I spend some of my time down here at the University of Arizona. But the two big things I think that are relevant to this conversation is I spend some time with Grace Hopper and Microsoft's Grace Hopper involvement planning. I've been to Grace Hopper. Who's familiar with Grace Hopper, first of all? So Grace Hopper is an annual conference that focuses on women in engineering. And last year, I think we had 15,000 people show up at Grace Hopper. Gandhi, I think you were one of them, if I'm not mistaken.
I was one of them.
You sponsor, I think, a few students that go to Grace Hopper as well, as part of the MIS department.
MIS sent about 15 people last year. Together with computer science, there were more than 30 of us.
Along with 15,000 of your closest friends. And it turns out that Microsoft sends a delegation. We had a delegation of about 800 people or so this last year. 38 of them were male. The rest were female. So I was one of the male attendees of Grace Hopper, but I also help coordinate our division's involvement in Grace Hopper, whether that's speakers or who's going to attend or the learning objectives that we get out of Grace Hopper. That's one of the things I do. And then I also, like I said, I'm the executive sponsor for our division's diversity and inclusion initiative. Before we get started in the regular talk, I'm gonna try to pep you up with this video. I think some of you may have seen this, so. If you have, I'm hoping that it's worth a redo. How many of you guys have seen that before? Anybody seen that before? When did you see it?
It was in my list to see, because I've been looking at all of the things that people are doing for diversity and inclusion. We talked about it to our clients in one of our projects. It was just on a tangent, but we talked about it and we found this.
Okay, good. Anybody else see this already? So why, what are some of the things that you guys got from this this video? Any key takeaways?
What is that?
any key takeaways for anybody in that video? Okay, I'm gonna tell you what my key takeaways are in just a second, but first I wanna tell you a little story. So, Satya Nadella is our CEO. He's been our CEO now for three and a half years. His first year as CEO, he was invited to speak at Grace Hopper, and somebody asked him the question, what would you do, or how would you coach women who want to get a promotion, asking for a promotion? And he is a genuine guy, speaks from the heart, really engenders a lot of loyalty and credibility at Microsoft just because he's so open and transparent. In this case, he stepped in it because he essentially said that you don't need to ask for promotion. You do good work, that good work is going to speak for itself. The company should then recognize that and promote you. And while that is true and consistent with his experience, it is not consistently true with some of the diverse population, even at Microsoft, that just do good work, and that good work is going to take care of itself. So Twitter kind of erupted within minutes after him making that statement. I think Gandhi was telling me it showed up on BBC as well. You know, it was an international disaster, almost, for the company. Well, you have other bigger disasters, but this one tended to generate a lot of news, a lot of buzz on Twitter and so forth. Within a week, Satya came back and said, you know, look, I realize that there's a lot of value in speaking from my experience, and I want people to appreciate the fact that I was telling them my experience at Microsoft. He hadn't once asked for promotion, and he eventually became our CEO. But he recognized that wasn't the experience that many people were facing even inside of our company. And that was kind of this pivotal event where Microsoft said, you know, we're going to double down our investments on diversity and inclusion. And some of the things that we need to do are train our leadership in terms of why diversity and inclusion makes business sense. We have a bunch of required trainings and so on and so on and so on. So this event, I think Satya took as an opportunity to come back, like I said, double down on diversity and inclusion. The reason why the video that I showed you is important, I think, is in a lot of ways that cool music and people collaborating and working together, everybody happy all the time and dancing on tables and whatever, is Satya's North Star for the diversity culture that he's trying to create at the company. We are not perfect, as you'll see. You can go up to our website and look at our diversity inclusion numbers. The number of women that we have in the company is around 20%, which is rather low. And we have a bunch of other underrepresented minorities in the company whose numbers are equally low. So there's a lot of work ahead of us, but there's a number of things that I'll tell you that Microsoft could be proud of in terms of our investment and the progress we've made around diversity and inclusion as well. Okay, a couple things that I want to talk about before I talk about what Microsoft is doing. The first one is the definition of diversity. So spend maybe just a minute and a half looking at that definition, and I want you guys to tell me what are the key takeaways from those definitions of diversity. So I'm going to give you, 45 seconds starting 5 seconds ago. A lot of drama in the room, it's so quiet, and tension. There's no grade associated with this series, right, Gandhi? So nobody's gonna fail at this next question I'm gonna ask. Okay, that was 42 seconds, so close enough. What are the things that resonate with you about these three definitions for diversity? Anyone? Yes, Reacher.
Yeah, I was going to say, the first part kind of talked about like the different levels of, you know, how you can be diverse, right? It's not just about race, it's about all sorts of different things. The second thing about understanding, like, that was the key word for me, from both people, from the whole group, and then putting that into, like, practice, like applying it as a third party.
Okay, great, great, great. Anybody else?
I mean, apart from bringing people together from different backgrounds and culture, what I like is the part about respecting your qualities and experiences of the other people that we generally miss out on.
Great.
When we think of diversity.
Great, perfect.
Yeah, I think the two keywords that stood out to me was understanding and appreciating, because once you kind of gain that empathy that we are different and we are from different backgrounds, and you appreciate that, that I think with that together kind of brings a lot of success overall. When you're understanding of all these different cultures and just seeing how we can all come together and just create something you never would have thought of before.
That's fantastic. Okay, you guys nailed all four of those things. So inclusion. The fact that diversity really is a very broad spectrum, at least as Microsoft and much of the industry defines it, it's not just about gender or race, but it's also about religion, it's also about diversity in perspectives. And all of those things, I think, are important to Microsoft. It's not just about gender or race. The next thing is understanding and appreciating. So once you include kind of this heterogeneous set of folks, unless you understand and appreciate the differences and are looking for opportunities to bring those different perspectives into the conversation, you're not going to get very far. And the last thing is making sure there's an environment where everybody has mutual respect. And so those, to me, are the four big things that kind of define diversity. At least for me personally, I think more generally for Microsoft as well. Questions, comments? Anybody disagree with any of that?
I have a question.
Yes.
And so diversity and inclusion makes perfect sense. But what I think is missing is, why are we not including in this conversation the construct of privilege? Because privilege also has so much to do with inclusion and equality. That seems to be part of the formula that's being left out.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think that Microsoft thinks about that, and I think other industry players think about that in terms of a big goal that you might have heard about called the next billion users. So the next billion users, the challenges of getting the next billion users online and to engage with technology have a lot to do with exactly what you're talking about, is how do we create an environment where we're providing consistent clean energy? How do we make sure there's internet connectivity? How do we make sure there's digital literacy, and how do we make sure there's financial inclusion for folks that are not as privileged as we are today?
And so maybe
I'm not covering that in this as part of this discussion, but I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah, and I think maybe I just wasn't articulate enough, but in a lot of institutions, and I'll just use it as white privilege, white males, right? So like, if you have a group of people that are coming in and you're talking to inclusion and equity, but we're still not addressing this particular segment of the population that might not even understand that they have a particular privilege that comes along with their gender and race.
Yeah.
So, and again, it might not include it, but if we're not talking about it, then we're missing, I think, at least, you know, half of the equation when we want to promote inclusion and diversity.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Microsoft's mission is empowering every person on the planet to achieve more. I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but I think that's the essence of our mission. And that everybody thing, I think, speaks to what you're talking about, for sure. The approach that we're taking around getting the next billion users online, the four things I just mentioned, is one of the tactical things that we're doing around that. I don't know, you raise a good point. I'm not sure how much we really think of that as a diversity problem versus an empowering problem. You know, maybe they're two sides of the same coin. But that's actually omitted from this because I think we tend to think of it more as an empowering thing than a diversity problem. But I'm actually happy to talk to you more offline about what we're doing on the empowering side as well, because I think that's an excellent point. Okay, anything else on this? So the next question is, why do we even care? So spend maybe 30 seconds, maybe talking to your buddy next door to you or something, and try to come up with the reasons why businesses care about diversity of their workforce and driving diversity and inclusion as kind of a corporate mission statement. Why do you think we should care about that? I'll give you a hint, there's more than one reason. So spend 30 seconds sort of just chatting with your neighbor about that. Okay, what'd you come up with? All of that chatter and there's not one business imperative behind diversity.
Yeah, so better ideas, more involved perspectives, taking your business global, and also because people are more aware of, you know, the importance of diversity now. So if companies do not really pursue it, it's difficult for them to make a better, you have a better reputation among people.
Okay, well, I think you called out two specific things there. That's great. What else?
I think also kind of going off what she said is that a lot of companies are now like realizing the importance of globalization, and when companies are trying to expand, only having one culture inside of a company when you're trying to think of different ways, so whether it be empower the world, you have to include the world in that and include different types of cultures. So I think, you know, as the world's growing, it's also kind of shrinking at the same time, so it's important to kind of include everybody in the business.
Great, fantastic. Anybody else?
Purely from a business standpoint, a company's wish is to stay on top, it's to be the best, and talents, in my opinion, talents don't have borders, and it's a good goal to have, you know, to include people from every corner of the world, to include all those talents and stay on top.
Good. Last call.
Maybe something investors care about these days, having diversity and having this in the company, so might be that is one of the reasons that diversity is important for business.
Yeah, and because I don't have a slide that supports that, so let me talk to that thing for just a second, and then I'll get into slides that I think echo the other points that were brought up. So increasingly, companies that buy our products are aware of the diversity of the talent that built those products and are starting to ask us about them. And so by extension, you can imagine shareholders being curious and interested in that problem as well. We and 70 or so other companies have made a commitment with the Anita Borg Institute, they're the ones that put on the Grace Hopper Conference, to be transparent about our diversity and inclusion numbers. Ours are up on our corporate website. I think many other companies do the same thing. So they don't have to dig very far, very long in order to understand how much progress we're making or maybe not making against those things. But it is a very important conversation that comes up in many of our sales conversations. So I think you're absolutely right. It's a shareholder issue as well. I don't have a slide on that, so I'll give you a bonus one for that. Okay, the other three things. The first is a more diverse workforce produces better products, and that's essentially your first point. It's not just us saying that. It turns out to be that there's a lot of studies that have suggested a very similar thing. One of the studies, I think we're going to share this slide deck. So these links at the bottom, you should go click on these links and read more. But it's one of the big reasons that we invest in it is because we believe a more diverse workforce builds a better product. The second thing is that a more diverse workforce tends to be more capable about serving a more diverse customer base. You tend to understand the needs of the audience you're trying to reach. We tend to make sure that customers that are diverse know about the diversity of our talent. So that if they have questions that are culturally biased or gender biased or whatever, they know that somebody on the other end of the phone is able to address those concerns. And then the last thing is a more diverse workforce tends to do a better job about attracting a more diverse workforce. And this issue is twofold. The first is that, yes, we want to bring more diverse talent into Microsoft because of the first two business objectives that I just talked about. But the second issue is that by 2020, your universities are going to generate much fewer computer science students than we think we need in order to fulfill the industry's needs. The numbers range between a third and a half. Now, H-1B visas can make up some of that, but not all of that. And you might be concerned how much more they're going to make up given the current administration as well. So what are we going to do about that problem? Well, the first thing is we want to encourage more participation in STEM, of course, but that's a long lead time investment. We have to go all the way down to elementary school, maybe even middle school, to make sure that there are more people, men and women, diverse backgrounds as well, interested in STEM. The second thing that's a little bit more tactical for us to do is make sure that we are getting our fair share of the entire candidate pool out there, not just white males, but also females and people of diverse backgrounds. And so for us, it's a big imperative to go after that talent, not just because the first two business imperatives, but because we think it's a corporate necessity to recruit from as a broad a base as we can, as much talent as we can. Now, given these three slides and the comment on shareholder value, was there anything else that somebody thought might be a business imperative behind diversity? Capture every thought in the room? Okay. So here's a little bit about what Microsoft is doing. This isn't everything. You can go up to our corporate website, Microsoft.com, and look at our diversity link down at the bottom and find much more, including some of the stats about the diversity of our workforce and the progress we've made year over year against that and what we're doing to drive it. Some of the things that are on our site, I'm going to talk about now. Our focus really is across four dimensions. The first one is this commitment around transparency. We believe that transparency drives accountability. As I mentioned a few minutes ago, Anita Borg has created this forum where I think 70 different companies are contributing their diversity statistics to the Anita Borg Institute, where they're able to reason across those, drive trends across the industry, help us understand best practices and so forth. But along with that comes this commitment that we publish our own numbers, as well as publish the progress that we're making against those numbers and the things that we're doing to drive that progress. The second thing is equality, making sure that we are paying, that we have equal pay for equal work, regardless of your background. It turns out that we're actually pretty good against that dimension. Women get paid 99 cents for every dollar that males get paid. That's among the best in the industry. Asian males get paid 5% more than white males. So those of you that might be applying for jobs from India or China, you can give me a high five on the way out the door. You'll be making more money than I will. The third thing is talent, and we've spoken a lot about attracting talent, but along with attracting talent is retaining talent and developing talent. Attracting talent is the first and perhaps the easiest part of the problem. Retaining that talent and developing that talent are two bigger problems, I think, in a lot of ways. Developing talent, it turns out that at least women tend to fall off in terms of promotion. So we have 20% perhaps women in our engineering workforce. That proportion decreases as you go up the seniority ranks. We have far fewer than that women at our CVP and executive VP levels, for example. And so developing talent is a big, big problem that Microsoft is also focusing on. And like I said, it may in some ways be more important and a bigger problem than the attracting talent thing that we talked about a few minutes ago. And then the fourth bucket is training. And training is a multi-dimensional investment. Among the things that we're doing is training all managers on the importance, the business imperatives behind diversity. We're training managers to understand we're training everybody on understanding their own unconscious bias. You know, it's kind of easy to point out your conscious biases. It's very difficult to point out and intercept and redirect your unconscious biases. So we have a bunch of training programs that help people understand where they might have unconscious biases that they weren't aware of. And there's training programs for diverse hiring. There's training programs even about writing job descriptions that are more gender neutral. Our search engine team has actually built heuristics that help hiring managers determine whether their job descriptions are in fact gender neutral, and then we run them through that filter to make sure that when we post a job, it actually attracts both men and women, for example. There's a bunch of things that we're doing in the training bucket, and probably more investments that we'll make in that training bucket. So those four things I think are self-evident: our transparency, our pay equity, our talent recruiting, retention, and development, and then the fourth thing is training program. A little bit about our culture for just a second. I'm only going to call out a couple things here, so I won't read this whole slide. But if you go back to Sacha's incident in Grace Hopper a few years ago, the one thing that he illustrated as part of that experience is his own growth mindset. Is everybody familiar with this growth mindset term? A growth mindset is this thing that enables you to get credit for achieving goals that you set out to achieve, but also gives you almost as much credit for learning from examples where you failed to meet that goal. So we will sit down with our employees every few months and talk about the performance that they've had over the last few months. And employees come to managers and say, look, here's the goals that I set out to achieve, here's what I actually did achieve, and here's the learnings that I garnered along the way. And as long as they're thoughtful about those learnings and apply those learnings next time around, it's almost as good as achieving the goal that they set out to achieve in the first place. Okay, does that concept make sense? What that allows us to do is aspire to things that we think are a little bit beyond our reach as well. Right? If you imagine a world where you're not going to get credit for the learnings, you're only going to get credit for achieving the goals that you originally committed to, you're going to tend to start cheating yourself about your aspirations and not aspire to things as lofty as you would otherwise. So this growth mindset helps our employees to aspire to big things as well, knowing that they're going to get full credit from the learning opportunities that happen along the way. So for Satya, he put his foot in his mouth at the Grace Hopper conference, but within a week, his own growth mindset kicked in and said, look, we need to do more as a company around diversity and inclusion, and that's why we're on the path that we're on now. And the other thing to call out is this diverse and inclusive. This is actually part of our culture, part of our value system is being diverse and inclusive, following the definition that we spoke about in the few slides above. Yeah, it's a mixture of both. If you're a manager, the suite of trainings that you're required to take is actually a little bit broader than every employee, partly because you have the recruiting and retention responsibilities. But it's a mixture of both mandatory and optional training. One of the mandatory trainings that we have is, what was the name of the class that we took where we had actors on stage who were acting out? So I'll tell you about the class. I forget the title of it. If I remember it along the way, I'll tell you. This class, we actually trained actors from New York City to come and role play for this training. So it's about a 4-hour long training event. Somebody's playing a gay man. Somebody's playing a black woman. She happened to be a black woman, so she's pretty good in that role. Somebody's playing a bunch of other kind of diverse perspectives. And they pretend that they're a feature team at Microsoft and going through challenges that illustrate some of their unconscious bias, some of their conscious bias, and so forth. It really is just a phenomenal training that, even though it's mandatory, there's more demand for that training class because it's been so successful than many other classes that we've had at Microsoft that are optional. It was just so well done that it's very highly regarded class. I just wish I could remember the name.
Dialogue across differences.
Thank you. So it's a mixture, and the requirements for managers are higher than individual contributors as part of that.
So you talked about retaining your talent, and it's actually a huge issue because we see very less percentage of women in the leadership team.
Yeah.
So what Microsoft is doing as an organization to handle this issue?
Yeah. So let me clarify something in your question, though. I think there's two issues that you're speaking to that are slightly different. So the development, by our definition, is taking somebody who's a university hire and making sure that person has equal opportunity to grow into a CDP. That's a development thing. The retention thing is there's a person that we bring on as a university hire, and they leave the company after 2 or 3 years. They're slightly different problems. It turns out the retention thing also contributes to the development thing a little bit, but there are two separate issues that we focus on. The biggest issue on the development side that we've focused on, I think there's three big things. The first is that transparency and accountability. So the metrics that we're talking about here, executive vice presidents and corporate vice presidents, so EVP, CVP, that's kind of the caste system at Microsoft, have commitments to their boss about their diversity numbers. And so it's not just that we're transparent about them, is they have obligations to move the needle against them as well. So that's thing number one. Thing number two is for roles above a certain seniority level, you're required to hold that position open until you interview diverse candidates for that role. So if you have a role that's, you know, maybe 8 years out of Microsoft, I'm sorry, 8 years out of university, you are required to hold that position open until you interview people from diverse backgrounds for that role. Now, you're not obligated to hire them, but you at least need to consider them against other candidates as well. And the reason that makes sense is usually the more senior roles that we have to fill, we know they're gonna take a while to fill, because you know it's harder for more senior talent to give up the job they have or to move or to whatever. So we kind of bake that into the recruiting cycle for the more senior roles that we're trying to fill. So it's not that big of an impact on the business. But the culture change is the thing that I mentioned, where you have to hire, or you have to interview a diverse candidate before you make an offer against that position. That help?
Yeah, it does. I can see some steps.
Yeah. Okay, any other questions? Okay. If you think about the transformations that we want that culture to impact, these are the four big ones. We want to move people from being aware of diversity to being accountable and celebrating a diversity. We want people to not just acknowledge differences, but really value and enable those differences and make sure there's differences in perspectives when key decisions are being made. We want to move from a position where we view diversity as kind of a narrow conversation about, hey, we need to get a women's opinion about this one feature, to an activity that happens all the time, it's just part of our culture. And the last thing is, diversity is not just an add-on to everything else that we do. We want to move from that to a situation where diversity is really a key business priority. Those business imperatives that we talked about, we're really trying to drive awareness and the importance of those things across our leadership team, all the way down to the line level manager level. Do these things make sense? Okay, so let me give you examples of four specific programs. And there's two videos that I have interspersed along the way. We go until 12 o'clock, is that right? Okay. So there's an initiative that called DigiGirls. Anybody familiar with DigiGirls? Anyone? Okay, yeah. So tell me about DigiGirls then.
Isn't it just like a program that it's pretty much helping in like middle school and high school girls get into STEM, like learning how to code and doing different types of STEM-related activities?
Absolutely, yeah, perfect. You just introduced the video that I'm gonna show.
Like, oh, this is DigiGirls, like, it's such an amazing experience, like, can I please go?
It's a cool place where girls get to explore technology with the help of Microsoft.
But it's a program that is for girls and to empower girls in technology.
It's cool that that they're doing this, because originally it was like, oh, computers, and now it's the next thing, hologram.
DigiGirls told us about HoloLens. I never thought that something that we see in sci-fi movies could come alive, and now that I see that it can, it makes me want to be part of it and like create stuff like this.
Basically jaw-dropping.
It really blew my mind. That was completely like mind-blowing. You're in an actual space, in a real room, and then when you get to go into a different space, it's not real, but you feel like you're in it.
Actual hardware, all the sensors is really cool too. I guess it's all pretty cool.
It's like, this is so real. Girls should be able to do this, and I feel like not enough get exposure to technology, and the fact that DigiGirls helps them do that is great.
I'm definitely considering a career in some sort of computer programming or maybe robotics, but now I'm like, oh wow, holograms would be really cool to work with.
Just the realization that this is real. I can do this now. I really love Microsoft now.
Well, it's definitely had me reconsidering what I want to do with my life. If this is the way the future of technology is going to go, it's something that I do want to be involved with.
I'm not sure why that was sponsored by HoloLens, as opposed to DigiGirls. So you're absolutely right. So DigiGirls is this initiative where we're investing in middle school and high school women primarily, though you might have seen one or two males kind of pop up in there as well. We're not trying to be inclusive. That is intended to generate interest and even confidence in girls' ability to work for a STEM career, academic career, and then take a job in STEM. So that's what this initiative is about. One of the things that we're focusing on now is how do we scale this across a broader portion of the globe. A lot of the mentors that you saw from Microsoft that are there because we have some presence in that community, whether we have a store there or a sales office or something else. We're also thinking about this program in the context of our data center regions, where we have 30 other regions around the world that are not necessarily associated with a store or a sales office. They tend to be more remote communities. And so can we bring programs like this to even places like Quincy, Washington, which is a relatively small community that many of you have never even heard of? Lean In Circles. How many of you familiar with the book that Sheryl Sandberg wrote on called Lean In? Great. Okay, wonderful. So Microsoft started, I think, 2 years ago this this initiative around Lean In Circles. I sponsor three different Lean In Circles in my organization. Sponsored by identifying some senior woman to lead them and paying for food if everybody shows up. And then listening to some feedback that comes out of the Lean In Circle about behavioral changes or structural changes that they want to make in the organization to better support women and diverse talent in the team. The next thing is this initiative called USpark. Everybody familiar with USpark? You will be, because I have a video about USpark that I want to show you.
Biggest thing I've ever won, and the trip to the Amazon was such a big opportunity for me.
We have been helping the community build a school kitchen. Can be very tough sometimes, but they're like, I feel very good because we're actually helping them.
It's nice to be able to step away from society, just throw myself into the work we're doing here, and really just live in the moment.
I love just being in the Amazon here. Like, you're present, but you're not necessarily connected to the friends that you're used to talking to. You're able to meet new people by just being here.
Just a while ago, I was able to meet some locals. They were so kind and so welcoming. I really feel at home here.
Technology is really good about making the world smaller. If we have 15 minutes of internet right now, it'd be really cool to find someone and say, hey, like, what have you always wanted to know about? And just let them use a tablet for 15 minutes and see what the internet can do for them.
This has been like tremendous. I had like a lot of opportunities, a lot of personal communication, learning new languages. There are a lot more things to learn in my life.
This trip has been great. It's been really humbling. It's like the only way I know how to explain it. It's been really, really, really humbling.
Anybody see that before? Is that new to everybody? So USpark is a program. Well, let's make sure we don't play another video here. USpark is a program where we're reaching out to youth in many cases from diverse backgrounds and empowering them to contribute beyond themselves, and as a byproduct of that, get them interested in computer science and so forth. This initiative where we sent down these four students to Ecuador to love and to give back to the community, you know, part of that is that we want them to be empathetic about populations that they don't normally come in contact with, partly they want to, we want to be able to support their interest in computer science, and partly we want to make sure that we're building their confidence that they go out, they can go out and make an impact in the world. So questions, comments on this? Yeah?
Why do we sign up for this?
So you can drop me an email. You can always connect with me on LinkedIn, and I can point you in the right direction. You can go up to our corporate website. You can find USpark there. So go to Microsoft.com and type in USpark, and you'll find things. If you can't find a specific thing to contribute to, reach out to me, and I can help connect. Yeah?
Is Microsoft doing anything at a university level for girls or women who are doing computer science to support them? Is there anything they're doing as far as that goes?
That's a great question, and in fact, one of the reasons that I got connected with Gandhi in the first place is that we wanted to start brainstorming with your university and some of those programs. We're not doing a ton here at the University of Arizona yet, though we aspire to, and we're working on a handful of things that we just talked about right before this session. We are kicking off a few programs at University of Washington. One that I'll tell you about now is that we have worked with the computer science department to select 22 dozen or so what we think might be at-risk computer scientists, you know, that are enrolling as freshmen in computer science. They tend to be people from diverse backgrounds, not just women, but minorities as well. And we're going to offer them a boot camp this summer and then connect them with a mentor for their first year to help make sure we support them and build their confidence and so forth. Those students will have an option to kind of extend that mentor relationship all the way through senior if they want. We're hoping if they do. And so that's a pilot program. Mm-hmm. There's a number of other things that we're doing at other universities around the country as well. We do have hack events there focused on gender. We sponsored the hackathon down here at University of Arizona with two prizes kind of in mind. Yeah, Hack AZ. I actually saw a number of people have Hack AZ backpacks on coming in the room, which I thought was kind of cool. So we sponsored two prizes this year. In fact, Bill, who's sitting at the end of the table, he was the sponsor for us. The two prizes were social impact and diversity. Right, those were the two prizes. So we are doing things like that. I wouldn't say that we have as many investments at the university level as we do at the high school and middle school.
Which makes sense, yeah.
Because we're trying to intercept and drive that awareness earlier on. But there's a number of things that we are starting to do around that. And like I said, Gandhi and I are talking about other things that we do here at the university.
I have a question. It has to do with the budget. So in the overall budget, like what percentage gets allotted to all your initiatives for inclusion and diversity?
Wow, I actually don't know the answer to that, but that's a great question.
You know, because I mean, you have marketing, and is this under the umbrella of marketing? Is it under recruitment and retention? Or, and again, it's just more out of curiosity.
Yeah, I don't know the amount. I think that at least the work that we're doing, we haven't run into a point where we've had to ask forgiveness for spending too much.
Okay.
I don't know if that helps. But in terms of who pays, as you're alluding to, it's actually a three-department thing. Recruiting and retention, for sure. Marketing, for sure. And then our executive vice president for community affairs, a guy named Brad Smith, comes out of his organization as well.
My quick comment on that. So one of the things that's happening, too, is what's happening throughout the company is we're making this part of how we do business. And so one example, we have these specific initiatives get the fund. But one specific example is in Windows, the organization I work with, there's a program called Windows for Everyone. And so the idea is to design the product so it's inclusive. And so in fact, one of the women that worked on that team just won an award for inclusive design. And so that's part of the development cycle. So you're not going to break that out as a separate budget item, but it's part of how we do business.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, last program I'm going to talk about is a program called LEAP. I don't even know what LEAP stands for, so don't ask me that question. But LEAP is this program where we take, right now, software developers that come from non-traditional sources. So not computer science graduates from university. These might be women who are re-entering the workforce after taking a break to raise their family. These might be underrepresented populations that haven't had a chance to go to a university but have gone to some coding academy and so on. But it's a program where we will connect these apprentices, essentially, with a Microsoft mentor who will work with them for 4 months to I give them coding assignments, programming assignments, kind of coach and mentor them. And at the end of that period, they have an opportunity to interview for a role at Microsoft. And so that's our lead program.
Just an add-on to that, I was reading about LEAP online. LEAP stands for Lean Engineering Application Program. So,
excellent.
Yeah.
Okay, fantastic. Did you catch that on video?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, good, thank you. Now I'm embarrassed that you knew, though.
I think you should get a prize here.
Okay. If there's extra credit, you can have to Gandhi.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to end with Go News. So I would like everybody in this room to commit to at least a couple of these things in the next 30 days. I'm not even going to open my eyes, but is everybody ready to make that commitment before we talk about these things? Okay, a couple of them are even fun. Okay, so it's not going to be that big of a hardship. The first one is invite somebody that you have no common alignment with out for a cup of coffee and have a chat. Super easy, might cost $5. Less if you go to Dunkin' Donuts and don't care about the quality of your coffee. I can point you to like three coffee places right on university that are within walking distance. So there's no friction there, right? Money is not an issue, getting there is not an issue. The issue is finding somebody that you don't have any commonalities with and invite them for a cup of coffee. The second thing is create or join a lean-in circle. I believe there's a handful of lean-in circles here on university. I'm not sure how well publicized they are. If there isn't one that appeals to you, you can create one on your own. But join one of these lean-in circles. Read Cheryl's book and then create one of these lean-in circles. I really think that the collaboration and discussion that comes out of these things tends to yield more empowerment and confidence and ideas about how to increase diversity. The third thing is, there's a number of opportunities that you have to work as a team on projects for some of your classes. How often do you find people that are similar to you to join your team? Versus how often do you find people who are different from you to join your team? My guess is many people do the former and not so much the latter. But with 3 months left of your academic year, is there an opportunity for you to pick somebody who you wouldn't otherwise select into your team to work on one of your school projects? I'll bet you there is. The fourth one that's a fun one, who's seen Hidden Figures? For those that haven't, you gotta go see that movie. It's just a fantastic, fantastic movie. For those that saw it, would you recommend that movie? Great movie?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Really, really, really good movie. Really good movie. The tear-jerking, sad part about that movie is a lot of the challenges that these women went through during the movie are still indicative of some of the challenges that they go through today. So hopefully you come out of that movie saying, oh my goodness, now I realize why this practice or this behavior or this culture is such a problem. I'm going to invest some of my energy and time into fixing that. I'm hoping that's what comes out of you watching that movie. If you do nothing else, find a buddy, find a date. It can't be that much money to go see a movie here in Tucson. Go see that movie. And the last is take at least two of the implicit bias tests that Harvard University has posted online. I have the link up there. Many of you guys might be familiar with those because one of the previous speakers actually spoke about bias, right? And I think she pointed you guys to the work that Harvard is doing to educate people about the unconscious bias they might have. These tests, I think, are eye-openers. Even if you feel like you're super enlightened and have the most progressive, kind of diverse and inclusive background like me, I feel like you go up to the side and it really is humbling about how much unconscious bias you still have in your system. So go do that, you'll learn a lot about yourselves. And that's it. Now it's Q&A for 6 minutes or something. So questions, comments, concerns, disagreements? Yes.
So we have talked a lot about positives of diversity, right? But I believe there are some negatives as well. So when I came here, I was kind of advised by a senior that make as diverse as you can. And that's what I did. But I have seen a few examples, not just here, but even in my work experience, that there are some challenges associated with diversity as well. So what's your thought on that? How do
I have a question and a comment. The first comment is I'm not sure that I would equate challenges with problems. So problems to me would be things like, you know, this is going to drive down our revenue or cause people to leave the company or cause us to make bad decisions. You know, those would be problems in my mind. Challenges would be like, oh man, the first time I got together with that guy who didn't agree with me, you know, it was really hard for us to figure out how to get aligned. You know, to me that's a challenge. That's all the reason that we're trying to be diverse and inclusive is to figure out how to overcome those challenges. So my question to you is, when you're talking about problems and challenges, are you talking about problems like business impacting things, or are you thinking about challenges, things that you just need to overcome as you are aspiring to be more diverse and inclusive?
So I was talking about challenges. I didn't really think about things impacting us.
Okay. So challenges, there are going to be challenges. I mean, I have a woman that works for me. She manages an engineering team. You know, to hear her experience about work is very different than talking to one of my male leads about his experience at work. Like that challenge and trying to figure out ways to help her be more comfortable as an engineering leader in our organization where she's leading more men than she is women and engendering credibility and respect from her team and whatever, to me is a big challenge that she's working through, and I'm trying to help support her in doing that. I think it's the right thing to do, and we're investing time to do that. I would respectfully submit that I think a lot of things you're talking about are actually challenges that you should invest to solve. Unless you really think they're business problems, yes, it's going to be painful, non-linear, a journey for sure.
Can you use the last minute to go
for your
quiz?
Oh, yes, I actually have a quiz here. So, am I supposed to give the answers or just the questions?
You can ask them the answers.
Okay. Because the answers are actually in the quiz. Okay, I'm not going to show you the slides. I actually have slides for the quiz. I can't show you because I have the answers. The first one is lean-in circles. What are lean-in circles? Very good. Not the crop circle thing, right? Okay, we talked about three benefits of a diverse workforce. Don't read the answer out loud. Is it A, B, or C, or none of them?
C.
What's a good definition of diversity? We also talked about that. This is way too easy. You guys are way smarter than Gandhi said you were. That's all. And then lastly, LEAP. What does it stand for? Okay, that's the quiz. That should have been super easy, right? Okay, do we have time for a couple of minutes of questions? What other questions or comments? I saw a couple other hands raised. Don't be shy. Yep, sorry.
So, this is one of the huge challenges that I was thinking when you are having home programs for divorce and specific programs for women. Does it create kind of a mental bias of men against women that are working and tie to the actual impact that you're trying to create?
That's a great question. So, I would put that in the challenge bucket, but it is one of the big challenges that we have. I hear a lot from the men on my team that holding a position open so that we can interview diverse candidates as part of that role unfavorably biases diverse candidates over men. Right? It's not exactly true. We're just trying to create opportunities for diverse candidates to apply and interview them as well, and we'll take the time to make sure that happens. But I think their initial takeaway on the surface is, you know, they're not qualified, or even if they are qualified, we're going to prefer somebody with lower skills than theirs. So yeah, there are those kinds of problems, absolutely. I think there's a lot of the males at Microsoft, you know, they might start to think about, well, what are you doing to support me? How come women have these lean-in circles and get to go to Grace Hopper and all these things? I would like to go do that. My explanation in general is you're more than welcome to spend your time and energy in helping solve some of these problems, and if you're invested enough in that, then yes, we'll invite you to Grace Hopper and you can participate in driving some of these challenges. But the whiny man who are just thinking they're not getting as many privileges as women, we don't worry about that one too much.
Yeah, Jesus, I just heard you have a special program for indigenous people or underrepresented people.
Um, No. It is one of the Native Americans or indigenous people is one of the diverse categories that we do track. I think our numbers there are rather low, 1%-ish, maybe slightly less than that. We are talking about, in fact, one of the conversations that we had with Gandhi and Dr. Brown right before this meeting was more about how do we understand the impact that we can have on Native American populations here in the Southwest, with the understanding that one of the things that we're constrained by is we don't fully understand what is the value system and how do we represent the benefits of technology into the Native American population without that accrues to the value system in that population. So one of the things I think that we committed to was investing in kind of in a listening tour sometime over the next few months or so to understand what are the needs, and then we can figure out what are the things that we can do to better support those populations. That was kind of what we usually maybe non-satisfying answer, but that's what we're doing.
How are you evaluating these programs, like how they're working? Are you doing like workplace climate surveys and before and after? How are you evaluating?
Yeah, great question. I think that for many of these things, we don't yet have the longitudinal data to know whether like DigiGirls is having a significant impact on the number of women that are applying for computer science programs. It is one of the things that we're investing in is how do we create these like the longitudinal metrics that allow us to track the impact of DigiGirls in terms of STEM graduation rates. The biggest thing that we're doing right now is inside Microsoft culture, we actually have our MS poll, Microsoft poll, that happens every year. It will be kicked off this coming Monday, coincidentally, where we do start to ask about perspectives about people in the workforce and understand whether women have as many opportunities as men and those kinds of things. So that's an internal thing. We also, like I said, measure our ability to recruit women into the workforce and our ability to promote women once they enter the workforce. I actually say women, I mean all underrepresented minorities as well. So those are the two big metrics that we focus on. Three big metrics, the poll, the cultural health of the organization, our recruiting, and then our retention and development.
Just earlier you were talking about holding a position at a higher management level until you interview all the people from all diversities, right? Do you think companies do that just because they're the representatives of the company? Why not hold a position for a young associate than the higher management?
That's a great question. So let me just change that definition a little bit. So we won't hold that position open until we find a diverse candidate. We will hold it open until we have an opportunity to interview one or more diverse candidates. And it's not only for managers, it's also for people who are a little bit more senior, maybe 6 or 7 or 8 years worth of seniority. So for a lot more positions than just a management position, we try to do that. We could do that for more junior candidates. I think one of the issues that made it easy for us to do that for more senior candidates is that we know the recruiting cycle for those is going to be long anyway, and that gives us a little bit more opportunity to hold the position open longer without having an undue impact on the business. I think you're right that we could extend that further down, at more junior levels of the organization as well. I don't think there's any big reason why not to. I'd have to go figure out why it is that we're not doing that. The only thing I can say right now is that those tend to have a much shorter recruiting cycle, but they may also tend to have more diverse candidates that we can interview, so may not have an undue impact on the business. I'm not sure, but it's a good question for me to go follow up on.
So Microsoft, the main hub is Washington State.
Yeah.
So Washington State inherently is a little bit less diverse as far as race and ethnicity goes than some of the other states, Arizona. So what is Microsoft doing to recruit from states outside of Washington to increase your racial and ethnic representation, since partnerships with UW may or may not have the impact that you're looking for?
That's a great question. You asked me a question that it's actually a threefold answer to. So the first is, you're right, I think one of our major hubs is the Northwest, Redmond, Seattle area. We actually consider our office in Hyderabad, India, and our offices in Suzhou and Beijing as other hubs. Those two centers have in the thousands of employees as well, so we consider those hubs. However, it turns out that Indian and Chinese males don't positively accrue to our diverse metrics because much of our population is male, almost equally broken up between white male, Indian male, and Chinese male. So we don't get credit for hiring more Chinese males and Indian males in that population, even though we have hubs in those regions. So that's thing number one, is it's not just one hub, it's those three. The second thing is that there is a big problem in recruiting talent into computer science roles, especially, and to some extent, MBA and MIS roles at Microsoft and across the industry. We are doing everything that we can in order to recruit from this university and every other university in the US to make sure that we're getting our fair share of US computer science graduates into our hub up in the Northwest. And we're trying to do that in a way that's as diverse and inclusive as those programs are currently constructed. So the diversity of your computer science program is actually a little bit less than the diversity of our workforce. So we can do a great job recruiting from your computer science program, but that's not going to significantly move the needle on our metrics. So one of the things that we're trying to do with a bunch of universities, and we just started the conversation with your university, is how do we increase the diversity of your students so that in turn it can increase the diversity of our workforce. That make sense? We have a university outreach department, I forget what they're called, but they actually support 18 or 20 universities around the US. U of A is not one of them, but they have a much bigger remit across those universities in terms of evangelizing Microsoft and trying to drive diversity programs as well. And those universities are just all over the place. So I think we are making a lot of investments to not only recruit from those different places, but maybe more importantly, make sure there's enough diversity going into those programs so that the outcomes are what we're looking for. Does that help?
Yeah. So I have a question. You're talking about computer science a lot, but you also mentioned MIS. How do we get the recruiting team, because our MIS program is very diverse, how do we get the recruiting team to understand that and want to come to an MIS career fair versus a computer science career fair?
I'm not sure if I tracked to the end of that question, so help me one more time.
So you're looking for diversity, but you keep saying computer science. So diversity, I think, could include a little bit, too, of different types of degree programs.
Yeah.
There's a diversity in degree program,
you're right.
MIS
yeah.
versus computer science. And within the MIS, which will have skill sets that Microsoft is looking for, we have a diverse group here at the University of Arizona. So how do we get the word out that they need to participate in more than just a computer science career fair, but also, I'm a career development coordinator, so I'm asking that question, to get them to come to an MIS career fair or Eller in general?
Yeah, that's great. So first of all, when I say computer science, that's my unconscious bias leaking through. That's my background as computer science.
Okay.
Of course, that's the lens I see the world through, is computer science. But you're absolutely right. I think Microsoft cares about the diversity of our entire workforce, not just the developers. And we're equally interested in making sure the diversity of your program matches the goals of our diverse workforce as well. When you say make sure that they are participating, do you mean Microsoft attending those career fairs?
Yep.
Send me an email. We'll be here.
Awesome.
Yeah. Bill or Elizabeth or I love to come down to Tucson and drink your beer and enjoy your sunshine.
especially when it's snowing at home.
Yeah. I think the bigger challenge is how do we start to say no to people that are willing to come down and do that?
Yeah.
So I think just making us aware of those things, I think is probably the only step that we need to take.
Perfect. Thanks.
Okay, we got to run to the airport. Thank you guys. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to you.